Good morning, everyone. Nice to see you all. You were listening to a wonderful work by Clara Schumann, one of the romances, as you came into the room. And indeed, we'll get back to that work later. So, as I said in my email, last week we were looking mostly at quite large through composed works. And today I want us to look at a kind of medium which is really quite special in the 19th century, the idea of a short work, a miniature. And as we'll see, some of these are standalone works. They're intended to be heard that way and experienced that way, and others actually form part of a larger whole. So I'll go straight into the music. So let's think a little bit about this idea. Song cycles, instrumental miniatures, we can have short works within larger structures. So for example, we will see short works within sets of pieces. And then some of the first works we'll have a look at actually are short standalone works. Now, as with last week, we saw that how much of Berlioz's ideas actually come from Beethoven's way of thinking. Beethoven also, especially in his later compositional career, started actually writing a number of very short works for keyboard. And these are called bagatelles. Bagatelles actually translates as trifle, or trifles. In other words, this idea of something which is ephemeral and short and over before you know it. You're looking now actually at one of the longer bagatelles. This is actually really quite substantial in comparison. Have a look at this one, for example. Over before you know it. But actually, I'm going to first turn our attention to songs. And it really would be amiss if we didn't consider the case of Franz Schubert. Despite dying at such an early age, was such a prolific composer, and of course well known for the song cycles, the Lieder, but also symphonies, chamber music including string quartets, of course large piano sonatas, but also in terms of the keyboard repertoire, much smaller pieces as well, impromptus and moments musicaux. And I'm just going to show you a painting, which is not from the 19th century, as you might tell. Now, this is a depiction of, if you like, hell, death, the end of the world. And I'll come out of screen sharing for a moment, because it's fair to say that death is something which really preoccupies much of a 19th century way of thinking. Indeed, I'm not saying that it doesn't preoccupy us now, but I noticed, for example, that Schubert died at a very early age, 31. This was not a particularly unusual age to die, of course. It was indeed. It's a very well-known Bosch painting. Thanks. I normally won't be able to see the chat, but indeed it is. And you can have fun, of course, looking up the image yourself later. I think that one thing that perhaps living in the modern age that we don't appreciate quite as much is just the fragility of human life. If you look at the biographies of famous composers and musicians from 200 years ago, not only would it be quite common to die young, of course Schubert's a very good example of this, Mozart as well died extremely young. Of course, that's offset by composers that for their time lived a good age. Haydn would be a good example of that. Beethoven actually dying in his late 50s was living longer than most. Not only the personal connection with mortality, but also in terms of their family. Many composers would have children that died. It was common for children to die in childbirth, for example. Indeed, it'd be common for women to die in childbirth. So I don't want to kind of state the obvious here, but I think that sometimes when we approach this repertoire with a very present-day sensibility, we perhaps forget this fragility of the human experience. So I'm going to go straight back in to another Schubert work in a moment. I'm going to show you another painting, which might actually give you a clue where we're going to go first. And this is a very common trope. Again, this is medieval, but it kind of pervades the idea of death and the maiden. Notice there also that death is presented as quite a skeletal figure. This is a 19th century impression of Death and the Maiden. Again, notice the kind of skeletal appearance of death. So some of you may know this song. It's a very well-known one. It translates as Death and the Maiden. And indeed, I was talking about Schubert's fantastic chamber music, and his 14th string quartet, the second last, is sometimes given this title because in the slow movement, it's a set of variations on the opening chorale melody. Now, there are two characters in the song, although it's sung just by one person. And what we can see immediately, Das Mädchen, the young woman, there's a lot of space in what she's singing, there's a lot of rests. She is higher in the register, it sounds a bit more frantic. This is amplified by the piano accompaniment. And then notice when death appears. Death is literally monotonous, meaning just singing the same tone for the opening few bars. Notice also we return to that ominous homophonic piano accompaniment. There's a kind of austerity to it. And indeed, this continues throughout, even though the melody begins to change. And then listen out in this recording for the wonderful low note at the end. It is optional, but when a singer does it and it's right on the edge of audibility, it can be very wonderful. We also notice that there's a sense of calm with death, and indeed the work ends in the major, perhaps suggesting that the appearance of death is not as malevolent as it might seem. Now, on the one hand, I feel a little bit guilty for starting off your day by playing you such a dark song, but it is also a remarkable composition. There is so much drama contained just within those few minutes. Notice also the way that the piano just keeps on going at the end, which is also quite an important statement. There's so much colour as well in this tiny song. Schubert actually takes this one step further in one of his earliest songs, and perhaps one of the most remarkable art songs in the history of music. And so it's a very well-known one. And I'm going to show you here the autograph manuscript, and it's for the Erl King, the Erlkönig. So I will take you through the text quite quickly. Obviously, we will put the slides online so you can see them, and indeed, you can look for them online. But there is a very clear narrative here, and there are actually four different characters. We begin with the narrator, and then on the fifth line, in verse 2, it's the father who is speaking to his son, asking him a question. In the next line, the son answers. And then in the third verse, we have the Erl King, who is singing to the son, and only the son can hear him. Now, I'll take you through the whole song in a moment, but this is a remarkable work on so many different levels. And it actually starts with this piano accompaniment. Believe me, ask any pianist, they will not want to play this for as long as it's written. It is really tricky. And I'm going to talk about that. It's really important, actually, because we could see as perhaps representing the riding of the horse. That would be fair. But you know what's also remarkable here is Schubert embeds the difficulty of the scene, this very fraught narrative, with the difficulty of the pianism. Now, it is fair to say that on the kind of piano that Schubert was playing on, it is not as difficult, certainly, but there's still a lot of difficulty there. And indeed, when this changes, it's at a very pivotal point. What else do we notice? So the narrator is generally in the middle register. There are some higher notes than that, but generally stays in the middle. Then as we go on, we notice this keeps on going, and then the father is lower. You can see that right at the top of the page. But then, so he's much lower, and then when the Erl King comes in, like the child, he is higher. So the Erl King and the child are in a similar register. The father is the lowest, and then the narrator is mostly in the middle. So already, even though there's only one singer, it clearly delineates the four characters. We also see some wonderful word painting here. So when I play, on the word play, we get this melisma, the little turn. Now this is a really nice example of word painting, which is very common in this type of song. In other words, something happens in the music that's literally reflecting the text. But let's just go back a moment, because notice what happens here in green. The piano accompaniment suddenly, that is so much easier than, believe me, anyone who's played this, the minute you get to that bar as the pianist, you're thinking, oh, finally, oh, thank goodness, I can relax. Now, isn't that ironic? It's as the Erl King is singing that suddenly the pianist relaxes. And of course, psychologically, the Erl King is enticing the child. So it's a beautiful kind of translation of the narrative into physically what is happening. As the child gets more upset, he is singing higher and higher, and the music becomes more and more dissonant, until at the very end, we see here, just notice that, my father, singing right at the top, the F and the G flat. And the use of register here is very important. But you will see that the Erl King takes the child, and it's very clear what happens at the end. Notice also the simplicity, and indeed it even marks the recitative at the end, those last three bars in comparison to the rest of the song. Now this is barely 4 minutes long, and as you listen to it now, you can follow the words, listen to the music, look at the score. It's just a marvel how much drama is encapsulated here. Thank you. Every time I hear this, and you can imagine I've probably heard it many times by now, it just takes my breath away. How much drama is compacted into such a short period of time. Now, there are many towns and cities in Germany that are famous for their musical connections, but by far perhaps one of my favourite is Leipzig. Obviously very famous for the Bach connection, but also where the Schumanns lived, and you can visit their home. And indeed the Mendelssohns as well. It also has one of the finest instrument museums in the world. And actually the last time I was there a couple of years ago, I heard an entire ring cycle. So for me, it just ticks all the boxes. We'll obviously get onto Wagner next week. But I want to turn now to the Schumanns. And I'm gonna start with Clara Schumann. Now, Clara Schumann is certainly more well known as a pianist, actually a very important pianist, not only in terms of kind of technical prowess, but also really thinking about the connection between pedagogy, pianism. She made lots of additions, so kind of combining musicological approaches with her performance. But she was also a very fine composer. Now, she certainly didn't write as much as her husband Robert, but there is nevertheless a very kind of rich repertoire there. And the majority of these pieces tend to be miniatures. Now, as we'll see when we get onto composers like Chopin, it's not unusual for a composer to predominantly be writing shorter works. Obviously, there were some practical reasons for that as well. Clara wasn't able to devote so much time to composition, but her songs and short piano works in particular are really worth exploring, and indeed in recent years have been performed more. Now, part of my point here is to show you this kind of really lovely work that you actually heard as you were coming into the room this morning. And it is actually played quite a lot now, but I have to say, 20 years ago, it was very rarely heard. People really didn't know it. So what I would kind of advise all of you as performers, indeed even as composers, is to seek out these works by people that you will have heard of, but you may not necessarily know the music, because I think sometimes you might be missing a trick. I mean, this is an absolutely lovely piece to program in recitals, for example. And there's a real strength in the music here. And as is kind of common in a lot of works from this period, the kind of motivic connections here are really important. It's very, very through composed. It takes small ideas and then develops them really quite masterfully. The musical language also is really quite chromatic. You'll notice as it goes on, the chromaticism intensifies. And we have also a wonderful connection between the piano and the violin. They kind of speak as one voice. Here we see them in sixths. And this particular chromatic motive, you'll hear in the short excerpt, combines with this one in red, and throughout we get much kind of invention. In green here, you can see that Clara Schumann is asking the violins to play on the G string and to stay there, and it gives the sound much more intensity, demonstrating that she's clearly thinking about the timbral implications of the music as well. So I'll play just the beginning of this, the first of the romances. Sorry to have to stop it there, but I hope you kind of see just it's a really, really beautiful piece. Now, something that I started talking about a little bit last week, particularly in terms of the Berlioz, but is a really important issue in the first part of the 19th century, is just the rapid development of instruments. Now, if you are playing a modern brass instrument, either in a brass band context or in the modern orchestra, you are playing an instrument that has developed a lot since this period. And really beginning from around about 1820, over the next few decades, every decade, there were remarkable developments in brass instruments, in wind instruments. Of course, the piano goes without saying, almost kind of every 5 years, the model is changing. And this really has an effect on the type of music that is being written. So I'm going to show you a really interesting example of this, and it is a work that some of you will have played in different contexts. So first of all, we'll go to Schumann. obviously known very much for song cycles, piano cycles, but also, although he didn't write operatic works as such, these larger scale symphonies, concertos, chamber music, really important. Now, I'm going to look at a relatively short work, just the first part of it, his Adagio and Allegro. Now, this is written for horn, but it's often played on other instruments. So you might have played it yourself on cello or clarinet or viola, etc. But there is something really fascinating about this work, written at the end of 1840s, because what happens here in the first bar demonstrates that it's been written for the relatively recent valve horn. Now, up until this point, we still see a lot of music that could fit in either kind of situation. So for example, horns before valves, so using only the embouchure and indeed the hand to modify pitches. Now, the onset of valves and instruments was actually quite tricky at first, and indeed it went under lots of different developments. And it's also fair to say that for lots of composers, they were not popular. Now, I'll give you a very famous example. If you're a horn player, I'm sure there are some here, if you are playing any work of Brahms on a modern horn, you're not playing for the instrument that he wrote for, because he never wrote for it. His father was a very famous horn player, and Brahms instead wrote for what's called the Waldhorn, the forest horn. That simply means the horn without valves. So all of the chromaticism in Brahms, for example, which is there, needs to be achieved through the use of the embouchure and indeed the hand in the bell. And hand stopping can also change the timbre. So if you listen to something like the Brahms Horn Trio, if you download the score on IMSLP, you'll see on the first editions, it says Waldhorn very clearly. If you listen to it played on a natural horn, you will hear these changes in timbre. Now, don't for a minute think that I'm some purist. I'm not going in a soapbox saying, oh, it must only be played that way. Of course not. But I think it's fascinating for us to consider this history. This is something we're going to get back to even in Wagner. It explains, for example, why even though he is writing for a type of valve horn, he keeps on saying things like horn in E flat, for example. So that way of thinking is really worth considering. Now back to the Schumann then. Obviously we don't have time to go into the technical detail, and brass players among you will be very aware of what I'm talking about here. But simply put, the chromaticism in that first opening two bars is something which is very idiomatic on the valve horn. And that's really what's amazing about this piece. I mean, it's one of the first works written for it, and we see in subsequent pages, for example, it uses that kind of idea again. Also the register, and going here all the way up to the written C, that's a concert F. I mean, still in orchestral writing, that note is relatively rare. And any horn players who ever play the Ravel G major piano concerto will know this very famous melody from the first movement. That's going up to the high concert F, and it's a very, very high note indeed. And we also get lower register writing as well. So an absolutely wonderful work, which is also showing us the inventiveness of Schumann in terms of writing for this very new instrument.
Thank you.
So absolutely wonderful writing, of course. I mean, even if you're not a brass player, I think you're just in awe of just all the colour and the sound. Now, remember what I said just now as well, which is that we don't tend to see any writing above that written high C in orchestral horn parts. Well, I want to share another work that he wrote quite soon after this, where he takes us all one step further. And indeed, you will hear and you will see a high written E in this passage, a concert A natural. So just to go into the screen sharing again. And the work I'm talking about, of course, is the Concertstück. So this is for four horns and orchestra. And here you're going to hear the wonderful horns of the Berlin Philharmonic with their youth orchestra. Just absolutely wonderful, isn't it? What an amazing kind of inventive sound. But again, it's worth us remembering these are new instruments, and yet he's writing with them for all the kind of fluency. Indeed, we often find over the development of instruments, and indeed voices, that we find often both performers and composers are trying to push the instrument further. There are very famous accounts, for example, in Beethoven, of his frustration, not only with his pianos, but with the people who are making the pianos, always wanting something bigger, something better, something stronger, something with more volume. And so it is remarkable. I want to go back now to looking at this idea of short works within larger structures. And here I'm going to go to Chopin. Now, you might remember last week I pointed out that Chopin, in his second piano concerto, uses collegno battuto in the strings. So there's a lot of kind of innovation in Chopin's music, but perhaps the real innovation is in this kind of mastery of the smaller form. So he's known for some extended pieces, of course, the sonatas, and all of his orchestral work is concertante. In other words, it has a solo piano part. And all of his chamber music involves the piano, so he doesn't write a notable string quartet, for example, and indeed, same thing with the songs. Now, a really good example of small pieces making a larger work is something like the Opus 28 and 24 Preludes. Now, as with the Bach Preludes, they are really thinking in terms of key relationships. The Bach Well-Tempered Clavier, of course, moves up chromatically, C and then C minor, then C sharp, then C sharp minor. Here, what happens is it's a little bit different. So we have C major to start with, and then you'll see there we have A minor. So we have the relative minor. See if you can see the pattern. We then have G major and E minor. And of course, the next one will be D major and B minor and so on. So it's moving basically in cycles of fifths and then with the relative minor. But there are also some really interesting thematic connections between these works that develop through all 24. Now, it is common to hear the preludes played separately. Sometimes pianists will choose to play them in groups, all of which works perfectly legitimately, but they also work as an entire set. So to show you one of those key relationships, this is quite a well-known prelude. A lot of you might have played it, and it's really characterized by this constant chromatic downward motion. You can see that everything here is affected by that.
Thank you.
and even where I've just finished, in the left hand, the C and B, right from the beginning. So that continues throughout. Then if we have a look at the sixth prelude now, the B minor, so a close look at the melody in the left hand here, and notice this figuration, the C sharp DB. Sorry not to play all of it, but remember that. And what do we get in this very short one here? Exactly the same. And then even here, embedded, we get that motive now developing through. So this is quite remarkable. It's not something that an audience would really need to know to enjoy the music, but clearly Chopin is thinking about these important relationships. I'll show you something else as well interesting. This is the famous D flat major prelude, sometimes called the raindrop prelude. So beautiful, of course. Now, we know that Chopin was deeply attracted to the music of Bach, indeed would play Bach preludes and fugues every day. And if you know your Bach preludes and fugues well, if you think about this figuration, very similar to one of the C sharp major preludes. And indeed we find other connections as well. The Opus 10 number 1 etude, that particular figuration, hey presto, so in Chopin we often get these Bach-like allusions. Now the preludes also operate often in sets, and so here the kind of calm and then the storm in the middle of the D flat prelude is answered very violently by the B flat minor prelude. And I'm going to give you a little taste of this with the wonderful Martha Argerich playing this live when she was very young. It's a little bit of a scratchy old recording, but it'll really give you the sense of the turbulence here. Extraordinary, isn't it? Kind of like a kind of bolt of lightning that just strikes you musically. So returning to the song cycle again, now we did have a brief look at one of Schumann's Liederkreis last week, and we considered the fact that there can be connections between those songs thematically. We also have connections harmonically as well. So this is perhaps the most well-known song cycle, the Dichterliebe, A Poet's Love. And here, if we have a look at the text, in the wonderfully beautiful month of May, when all the buds are bursting open, there from my own heart bursts forth my own love. Now, just taking that in the abstract, that would seem to indicate quite a nice mood. Wonderfully beautiful month of May, isn't it? When all the buds are bursting open. But we'll see that really the music is giving us the ending. So have I confessed to her my yearning and my longing? And the remarkable thing about this song is the way it just doesn't want to resolve.
Im wunderschönen Monat Mai, als alle Knospen sprangen, da ist in meinem dir gestanden, mein Sehnen und Verlangen.
So the tonality of the song is moving between A major and the relative minor F sharp minor. And then that, of course, is the dominant of the minor, but ending on the dominant. And actually, it then takes us immediately into the next song, which seems to resolve this. And yet, if we have a look now at the text, again, from my tears sprout forth many blooming flowers. So this connection, this constant kind of sense of bittersweetness is very much pervasive in this setting as well, even though it seems to resolve the previous song.
Aus meinen Tränen sprießen viel blühende Blumen hervor, und meine Seufze werden ein Nachtigallenchor. Und wenn du mich lieb hast, Kindchen, schenk ich Blumen an, und vor deinem Fenster soll klingen das Lied der Nachtigall.
Notice again how the piano so often will actually end and take over from the voice. Now, I'm going to end with one of the longer songs in the cycle. Quite an extraordinary one. So this is Im Rhein, Im schönen Strome. Now, Im schönen there means in the beautiful river, and then you'll notice in the text, it's the holy river. That differentiation is actually quite important because other composers have set this, and some of them don't use the word heiligen, holy, at all. Some of you will probably be familiar with the great Cathedral of Cologne, the Dom. If you aren't, here's a very kind of sunny, nice photo of it. You can see it there on the right-hand side. However, I'm going to share one of my own kind of snaps. So I took this, I think, the year before last. You see there's maybe a little bit more austerity. It was a rather gloomy day, actually, which doesn't help. But there's something mightily awesome and impressive about the cathedral. And this is very much reflected in the music. But if we go back to that first verse, notice in the English translation there, it's all about great, the big, the great city, the great cathedral, the holy river, of course, the Rhine, massive. Now let's have a look at the second verse, in the cathedral. So suddenly going inside. But even that isn't enough. In the cathedral, there hangs a painting. So it's like this extraordinary zooming in from this massive kind of image of the outdoors, the great river, the Rhine, the great cathedral. And suddenly there's this painting, painted on gilded leather. In the confusion of my life, it has shone kindly down upon me. It's extraordinary, isn't it? The sudden introspection. And then the final verse, now reflecting on the details in the painting. Flowers and cherubs float about her dear lady. Her eyes, her lips, her cheeks are exactly like those of my love. Now, it's an extraordinarily beautiful poem anyway, but... Sorry about that. We're going to actually hear it in a minute. It'll go straight into it, so I'll just explain it first. You will hear that there's a kind of austerity in the way that Schumann sets this. It almost sounds like non-19th century music. It sounds like it could be Bach or something, the use of counterpoint. There's also some very simple word painting. So it begins. So the The great dome, the Cathedral of Cologne, is reflected in the waves. And when it says reflects, suddenly we get an inversion, if you like, a type of reflection. So there's that. But the most remarkable thing is what happens as we get into each of these, the second and the third verse, the music becoming increasingly more intimate, beautifully so, almost painfully so, and then the very ending, just to have the piano finish.
Im Rhein, im heiligen Strome, da spiegelt sich in den Wellen mit seinem großen...
And so I'm actually able to show you some...
Da steht ein Bildnis auf goldenem Leder.
And then as we go on to the next verse.
Es schweben Blumen und Englein um unsere liebe Frau, die Augen, die Lippen, die Sänglein, die gleichen.
So I'm now going to leave you with the whole song, and you can feel free to leave the Zoom room when it's time, because we're exactly at 10:50 now. As I said in my email, next week we've got quite an undertaking, because I want to talk to you about a work which is over 15 hours long in 50 minutes. And we will go through the whole thing, but in a very condensed version. So I'll introduce you to one of the great works of Western classical music, Wagner's Der Ring des Nibelungen. But here, let's just end with this wonderfully intimate and equally powerful song. You might notice that I'm quite fond of Ian Bostridge recordings. There are other tenors and other singers available, so I do encourage you to listen to other recordings. But meanwhile, I'll leave this with you, and I'll look forward to seeing all of you next week.
Im Rhein, im heiligen Strom. Spiegelt sich in den Wellen mit seinem großen Im Dom, da steht ein Bildnis auf goldenem Leder gemalt. Im Rhein.
There's a little problem with my sound. I'll just try and play it again, but do feel free to leave if you have to. Sorry about that.
Im Rhein, im heiligen Strome, da spiegelt sich in den Wellen mit seinem großen... Da steht ein Bildnis
im Rhein, im heiligen Strom.
That's becoming quite comical, isn't it? Okay, I will urge you then just to listen to the work online. It's so easy to find. So I'll just say a normal goodbye to everyone. Look forward to seeing you all week, and I'll ensure that all the multimedia is in the right place for that. Bye now. See you all.